Good morning.
Morning.
Well, this week I found out the difference between a retired guy and an almost retired guy. A retired guy says, I'm going to pay someone to move that. And an almost retired guy says, I think I can still move that myself. And my back is killing me. But the really heavy stuff is actually getting moved today, and that's one of the reasons Sarah is not here this morning, is because you kind of have to go on the move's timetable, and so they are moving the big stuff as we're meeting for worship this morning. And so tonight will be our first night in the new house, and we're excited about getting there and not looking forward to cleaning up the old house, which we still have a lot yet to do, but bit by bit we are getting there. I want to go over some of the announcements on your bulletin insert for today. A couple of committee meetings this week. A Property and Maintenance Committee is going to meet Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. And then on that same day at 5:15, Worship and Evangelism Committee meets. The session has called a congregational meeting for 2 weeks from today. And the purpose of that meeting is to elect a pastor nominating committee. We are not exactly sure how big the committee is going to be yet. The session still has to make that decision. But if we have two members of session on the committee, then we will have three at-large members elected from the congregation for a total of five. If we have three members from session, we'll elect four at large to have a total of seven. So we've got to have an odd number, and we always have one more person who's at large than on session. So we'll be making that decision at our next session meeting a week from tomorrow. But be thinking about if you might want to serve on the pastor nominating committee. The reason that we're calling the meeting for this time is we have finished all of our surveys with Holy Cow Consulting. I think the last total I saw was 61 surveys turned in, so that's a pretty good number. And we're going to get the results of that on August the 17th, I believe. And so we would like the people who are going to be on Pastor Nominating Committee to be in on that session where we learn the results of that survey. That'll be the first step toward writing a church information form and, you know, getting going on looking at candidates to be the next pastor here. And so give that some prayerful thought and talk to others about their interest if you think they might be good on that committee. And so 2 weeks from today, we will elect that group. Also, Cuff Dinner is coming up Thursday, August the 11th, and there's a sign-up sheet in the Narthex posted for that, so please sign up on that if you haven't done so already. That's all the announcements I needed to cover with you. Anyone else have announcements you need to make today? Okay, then I'll turn it over to Kym for our call to worship.
Please join me in our call to worship. It's a responsive reading found in your bulletin. We are children of God, learning to walk.
Day by day, we are learning to be the church.
God is a loving parent, teaching us to walk.
God loves us, leads us, and feeds us.
Please stand as you are able for our first hymn, number 620 in the hymnal, Praise My Soul.
Thank you.
nurturing God, you continue to lead us in the right ways on account of your love for us.
Yet we do not always follow your call.
We turn away from you and go our own way.
Forgive us and return us to our right home in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
From our God. I cannot give up on you. My compassion grows warmer and tender. When my children come trembling, I will bring them home. Believe the gospel. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Let us sing glory to God.
thanks to Lisa and Sarah. You know, summer special music has just been really great this summer. We have just gone from highlight to highlight, and thanks to all who have been part of that, and appreciate the contribution you're making to our worship service. Today, the gospel reading is taken from Luke's gospel. We continue to follow along with Luke and the lectionary. And today, the text is from chapter 12, verses 13 through 21. Hear God's word for us on this day. Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And then he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man produced a good crop. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of good things laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.'" But God said to him, "You fool. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Sometimes when we read these parables of Jesus, if we read them closely enough, we ask ourselves the question, did Jesus get it wrong? One day, this anonymous guy in the crowd says to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to share the inheritance with me." Have you been in that room? Have you been in that room where the last will and testament has been read, and it's not exactly spelled out clearly who gets what, and so you're trying to decide who gets which piece of furniture, who gets the dishes, who gets the house, who gets the land, who gets the bank accounts. Now, it can all be amicable, but it can also get ugly. Apparently, this was one of those times when it got ugly. And so the man asked Jesus to be a referee in this dispute. "No thanks," Jesus says. "It's not my job to decide whose greed is right." Now, let me tell you a story. And he tells them this parable about a man, a wealthy man, for whom life is about to get even better. His land has produced a bumper crop, a crop so good that his barns just can't hold it all. It creates quite a dilemma for the man. But being a good, common sense businessman, it's not something beyond what he can figure out. So he says, "I know what I'll do." He says to himself, "I will tear down my old, small barns and build bigger ones." Problem solved. Then I will sit back, eat, drink, and be merry. And God says to him, you fool. But we would probably be better off hearing that line as addressed directly to me and to you, saying, you fool. And it will ruffle our feathers. For everything that the man did in this story is exactly what we would have done had we been in his shoes. Save something for a rainy day, right? It's an old biblical principle. Remember the story of Joseph? Joseph was sold into slavery in Egypt, but eventually he rises up to become Pharaoh's right-hand man. Joseph has all of these dreams, you'll remember. And in one of those dreams, he dreams that the land is going to produce great crops for 7 years, and then the 7 years following that will be a famine. So he tells Pharaoh, and then Pharaoh tells all the people, save up during these next 7 good years so that you'll be ready for the 7 bad ones to follow. Saving up for a rainy day, it's the perfect strategy. So why does God say to him, you fool? Did Jesus get it wrong? From our vantage point, we have to wonder. I know Jesus is Jesus and not me, but still, there's something odd about this. Let's start to unpack things by looking at how this story differs from the story about Joseph. The first thing that's going to jump out at you is that all of the saving that is done in Joseph's story is done for the good of all of the people. The saving in our parable is just for the rich man himself and nobody else. Secondly, Joseph makes his recommendation to Pharaoh based on being open to God's vision. It's God who tells Joseph what's going to happen. The rich man considers only himself. In fact, the text literally says he dialogued with himself. There is no thought of others here, no thought of God. It's all I, me, mine. In Joseph's story, the idea of saving is balanced with giving glory to God and caring for neighbors who are in need. The theologian Augustine had a great line about this story, you know, 400, 800 years ago, whenever Augustine, 800 years ago, whenever Augustine lived. He said, the rich man did not realize the bellies of the poor were better storehouses than his barns. The rich man didn't realize that the bellies of the poor were better storehouses than his barns. It's all about having an accountability before God for what you've done. An accountability for others, for what you've done. For the rich man,
you fool, God says to him, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And who's going to get all this stuff that you have prepared? What's your thought? The rich man isn't given a chance to answer that question. But if we are in his shoes, and we are, this is how we might answer that question. Well, if I go, all of this will go to my children and my grandchildren. If we said that, would God still say to us, you fool? Perhaps. For we are accountable first and foremost for how we live our lives, not how our children and grandchildren live their lives. We may think that we're passing on our riches to them. Is it possible that instead we are passing on our greed? Is it possible that we are passing on to them that our sense of security comes from our possessions rather than coming from our trust in God? Perhaps. Probably. Maybe even definitely. Parables are tricky. As one theologian points out, they are not explanations. They are not illustrations. They just plant a seed in your imagination, and then they work on you. They don't make life easier. They make it more complicated. They force you to think about things that you would prefer to ignore. They change your angle of vision. Jesus told this parable to expose our greed. Greed is like a tiny parasite. It is an almost invisible sin. It works its way into you and then starts growing, and before you even know what's going on, greed has charge of the whole system. Greed eats away at our generosity. We use what we've got to get more and more instead of using what we've got to give away more. Parables get inside of you. They work on you. If I were to identify with the rich man in this story, the fool, eventually I might ask myself the question, well, what do I need to do to be less foolish? It starts with including God in the conversation when we make our financial decisions. It includes thinking about the needs of others and not just my own needs or the needs of my kids or grandkids. This parable ends with the line calling us to be rich toward God. What does that mean, to be rich toward God? It means not only including God in every aspect of our lives, but putting God in the center of every aspect of our lives. In the parable that we just read, it doesn't say this, but it wouldn't surprise me if that rich man went to worship every single week and thanked God for all of the many blessings in his life. He just didn't focus on God the rest of the week. Because after all, church is church and business is business. For him, and perhaps for many of us, those are separate compartments in life rather than being an integrated whole, where God influences, is at the center of every single decision that we make. One of the theologians, preachers that I quote a lot, you know, because you've heard me preach for 18 years now, is William Wilman. And Wilman often has a way of being that pebble in your shoe, that kind of irritating thing that you wish you could ignore, but you just can't. His preaching style is sort of like a parable. It forces you to think about things in new ways. And one of the things he said in commenting on this parable that we read this morning, is that offering time in worship is the least liked thing in any worship service. Because in that moment, it says, when the music is at a crescendo and we're singing in the doxology and all eyes are forward, we see that foolishness is not just in our greed, but also in our worship. God asks us to tithe our income. If we were to do so, Willeman says, then perhaps that would be the beginning of right worship and the end of our foolishness. Amen. Our hymn is number 693 in your hymnal, Though I May Speak. And after our hymn, we will remain standing for our affirmation of faith. This morning, we'll take it from the brief statement of faith, an excerpt, part 3, that is found on pages 37 and 38 in your hymnal. So I invite those who are able to now stand.
Amen.
just affirm what we believe, again, using part three, which starts about two-thirds of the way down the page on page 37. We trust in God, whom Jesus called Abba, Father. In sovereign love, God created the world good and makes everyone equally in God's image, male and female, of every race and people, to live in community. But we rebel against God. We hide from our Creator. Ignoring God's commandments, we violate the image of God and others and ourselves, accept lies as truth, exploit neighbor and nature, and threaten death to the planet we trusted to our Creator. We deserve God's condemnation. Yet God acts with justice and mercy to redeem creation. In everlasting love, the God of Abraham and Sarah chose the covenant people to bless all families of the earth. Hearing their cry, God delivered the children of Israel from the house of bondage. Loving us still, God makes us heirs with Christ in the covenant. Like a mother who will not forsake her nursing child, like a father who runs to welcome the prodigal home, God is faithful still. There are some cards back at the narthex for you to sign today. First of all, a card to Ashley Hubble.
Yes.
Did I pronounce it? Who is the new director of the museum. I can see Ray breathing a sigh of relief from here. glad to have that position filled. And so it's a congratulations card to her. Also a congratulations card to the IHS Diamond Dog Dance Team on all the honors that they have earned at camp. Drew O'Brien's one of the dancers. I'm not sure if we've got any other kids. Oh, no. Rodriguez, Alex, I think it
might be Martin. She's cheer.
She's cheer. I can't keep the cheerleaders of the dancing people squared away. Congratulations to the dance team. And then also a get well wishes card to my mother, Virginia. She, as I mentioned, a couple of Sundays ago had fall and was in the nursing home part of the facility where they lived, which she hated, which was great motivation for her to get well enough to get back to her work, which she has. So we're grateful for her recuperation to this point, and I wish that it continues. And so those are the cards for today. Not only did my mother have a fall, but also that Jenny Kelly also had a fall recently, and like my mother, broke a couple of ribs, and so prayers go out to Jenny this morning. And then I had a request this morning also just to keep our nation in our prayers this week, and so we will do that this morning. Are there any other people to add or any updates on the folks today? Okay, let us all then go to God in prayer. O God, our rock and redeemer, and comforter of all who call on your name, you are God and there is no other. All else fades and withers, while you endure throughout the ages. With angels, prophets, apostles, and martyrs who have gone before, joy in giving you praise and thanksgiving. Your grace abounds. We receive of its abundance. You exceed our expectations and needs. There is never a day that we cannot miss the manifold gifts of your abounding love. From morning until nightfall, we are upheld by your encompassing care. Having been raised like Christ, we will set our minds on your heavenly splendor. We will trust your Holy Spirit to guide us when earthly desires distract us. We confess that we are prone to temptation, but by your grace, we can put on the new nature Christ bestows. claiming our inheritance as your sons and daughters. We shall go forth to all people as witnesses to your rule. Let us not covet what our neighbors enjoy. Prevent our worship of false gods, and stop our tongues when we would slander brother or sister. When we eat, make us mindful that you are the source of all nourishment. When we drink, may it be the cup of new life. Help us to be merry in the joy of your spirit, as we give you the glory and honor due your name. We pray today, especially for our nation, for Jenny, for Anita, Sylvia, Charlotte, Savannah, Michelle, Nikki and Rick, Jackie, Joan, Vicki, John, Melissa, Brent, Andy, Evan, the people of Ukraine, Art, Joan, Lucinda, and John. We pray this morning for our session, for Judy, Elizabeth, Rob, Kim, Fritz, Elena, Jeff, Lyle, and John. All of these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In 2 Corinthians, we read, "Give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves the cheerful." Let us present God with the offerings of our lives and our prayers. Join me in the prayer of thanksgiving and the Lord's Prayer printed in the Word. Let us pray together. Holy One, we give you thanks for the richness of our lives. Bless these tithes and offerings, that they might be used as expressions of your steadfast love for those in need near and far. We pray this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Not in the temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn today, number 708, we give thee but thy name. show you what is good. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that